It was on a December night, within the maze-like compound known as Charles de Gaulle Airport. The harsh winter conditions outside made it difficult to pace through the Paris streets. And this silent struggle had taken my last breath as I walked into the airport. It was snowing quite a bit. I'm not exaggerating when I say that the temperature was barely 5 degrees Celsius. Because I was used to the cold, the air frost seemed most painfully harsh. Even breathing far from a heated building was horribly painful. It was as if the air itself could freeze you solid and tear you apart after taking a single step outside. At least, that's how I felt. I had been traveling from one global city to another to attend strategic meetings, and right now, I was coming back from the US along the group that had accompanied me to close a major business deal. To our luck, everything had gone smoothly, and thankfully, the future looked bright. There was an atmosphere of joy among us, or so it seemed at first. As we walked through the security, my eyes were somewhat drooping, as the day had been agitated, and yet, I had a weird feeling about the unusual ambience that shot through the fight connection complex. The crackling. No, it was the irritating beckoning of people's voices that now felt as if everyone around me was slowly fading away. Quick, we don't have much time. The loud and volatile whirl of the air hub suddenly burst out of one of my companions' voice as we hurried to where our flight gate was. My traveling companion was talking about me, and although I have a dim memory of it all, I think he said something along the lines of good work with the executives, and we had Diego around to translate everything. As we strolled down the endless mechanical walkway to our gate, I heard another voice calling my name in the background. I felt strangely dissociated from reality, though this was just a side effect from exhaustion. It was around 10:40 p.m., 20 minutes before our flight, and that's when the fateful encounter occurred. As I walked past a cafeteria, the sight of my peripheral vision got onto something. A darkish, brown-haired silhouette and an unforgettable voice. My eyes, reddened by sleep deprivation, were barely able to discern anything. But it was as if something suddenly struck my mind and made me halt and turn that way. And then, it hit me. The person I had just glimpsed was none other than my sister Karina. And an overwhelming sense of consciousness swept me away, almost as if I had just realized some deep, strange cosmic truth. The mixed feelings shooting through my heart blinded my logical thinking, and the vague awareness that I had of my surroundings shifted towards Karina, who was all smiles. And so I took a step towards her.
Diego, Diego, ¿qué haces por aquí? ¿Cuánto tiempo ha pasado?
Her voice was exactly how I remembered it. It had a certain sharpness that struck the unsuspecting listener as a knife. Yet, there were melodic undertones of contradicting kindness rolled up in her speech that made her voice sound harmonious in a way. I was honestly shocked, thinking all at once, what now? How? And why is she here? It had been at least 10 years since we last talked in person. It felt amazing though, I won't lie. I was thrilled and shaken with intense emotions. I felt incredibly energized again, as if all the weight of the world had been lifted off my shoulders and nothing mattered anymore. We both rushed into each other's arms and hugged for a long time.
Karina, ¿cuánto tiempo? ¿Cómo has estado? ¿Cómo te ha ido en España? It was 10:42 p.m. I was overjoyed. She paid for her food and asked if I wanted to grab something to eat, to which I said no. And as we got on our way, we were joined by one of my friendly colleagues who was curious to meet my sister. He reminded me there was little time left before our flight and went back to walking ahead with the rest of the group. I think I caught a smile on my sister's face. We looked at each other in silence and continued walking towards the departure gate. I remember we talked excitedly about everything that went through our minds in that moment. Granted, it wasn't in much detail, and I can't remember most of it, but I guess it was nice. She was working in Spain with an athlete who was participating in the Olympics. In all appearance, her job as a nutritionist had worked out well. I asked her about her relationship with Samu, to which she replied that it was going great. I also told her about myself, explaining that I was heading back to Switzerland, where I would stay for some time, as now I was working as a full-time translator for a diplomatic group. It felt relieving that we were both happy and successful, especially since it had been a long time since we last met, and we never really updated each other about what was going on in our lives. By 10:50 p.m., we made a quick stop at a small stand where they were selling coffee. You still love coffee as much as before, don't you? Here, I'll get us some. One espresso with sugar and one frappuccino, right? She shook her head in an affirmative nod, and both coffee orders were confirmed. We'd be sitting at a small table waiting for like 5 minutes when the waitress finally brought our order. Karina protested ostensibly. She was still as rough as before. She asked why it took that long just to make 2 coffees. However, much to her dislike, she got no reply from the young woman who didn't speak a word of Spanish. I took a sip and it seemed that my coffee had no sugar, which I mentioned out loud without thinking. Well, let's say Karina wasn't happy at all, and she kept complaining loudly about the poor service. I wasn't too bothered by the fact that my order was mixed up, but I guess I realized then that my sister had always been like that. She always acted more feared than I was. It seemed as if the person taking the order had misheard with no sugar, and while I didn't want to whine about it, well, it seemed my sister clearly had an issue. And so, she called back the waitress.
Mira, mi hermano pidió un café con azúcar y le trajiste un café sin azúcar. O sea, tan difícil es escuchar lo que te dicen. Tráigame el azúcar ya.
I was honestly shocked. A mechanical voice began calling out from the airport speakers, but I ignored it. I kept listening to Karina, fighting with the speechless waitress. And though anyone else would have been surprised at my sister's aggressive tone, I was not. Karina had always been sharp with her tongue. I even used to say that she could stab someone to death with mere insults. It was as if she could spit out the sharpest swords to pierce through your heart with her words. Her unique tone helped a lot in this aspect. The fact that she was a quick talker with a voice that was more melodic than most girls gave her a very confident, passive-aggressive attitude that many wished they had. If only to be able to taunt her back. I mean, she had such an easiness at being hostile. I think it was a good thing for her. And I guess it was truly her own way of always having something to say. I remember she always publicly stood up for me when things weren't going my way. And I didn't even have to ask. Karina was extroverted, and she was more than willing to make it everyone's issue. That day at the airport, I felt good. I was so glad that we were once more chatting just like before, as if the year hadn't gone by and everything was still the same.
She, the bold-spoken person, and I, the quiet confidant. Hearing her voice again felt wonderful. Suddenly, and without a concrete reason, I looked down at my hands. My eyes froze on my wristwatch. The clock was about to hit 11 p.m., which meant it was probably around 10:58 p.m., because, well, I have this quirky thing about passing time too quickly. Gerascophobia is the medical term for it. So I always set my watch early, just to be sure not to miss out anything important. It was then that I dazed out of my sister's rant about, what was it again? Oh yes, of course. Now she was going on about her new social media workflow, because by then, she had moved on from her public outrage against the silent waitress, and she was making a point of trashing the airport coffee shop's brand status online.
Pésima experiencia. Servicio inaceptable. Le doy una estrella a la mesera por no atreverse a negar su mediocridad profesional y le quito dos por no hablar español.
Then, I started to pay closer attention to the repeated announcements coming from the airport speakers that I had been ignoring this whole time.
Diego Viteto, vous êtes attendu en urgence à la porte 3. Monsieur Diego Viteto, vous êtes prié de rejoindre la porte numéro 3 pour un embarquement immédiat.
I quickly jumped from my chair while plunging my hand in my jacket's pocket to take out my black Montblanc wallet out, and I swiftly threw some spare cash on the table as my eyes darted at my sister.
Mira, Karina, me tengo que ir porque si no voy a perder mi vuelo. Bueno, nos vemos.
She, however, was too distracted checking her phone. Community management is the digital term for it. And before she realized, I had already rushed towards my flight, bound to another life. The two coffees were left almost untouched.